We move on to the next agenda of the CME. We would have a talk on the approach to a crying infant by Dr. Padma Priya. About Dr. Padma Priya. Dr. Padma Priya is an MBBS, DCH and DNB in pediatrics. She's had a neonatal training in Sydney, Australia. She graduated from Keelpok Medical College in 1988 and went on to do pediatric specialization at ICH between 1990 and 92 and later at Kanchi Kamakodi Children's Hospital as well. She's been in pediatrics since 1993 and went on to have advanced neonatal training in 1997 to Sydney, Australia. On returning, she served as consultant neonatologist for 12 years at KKCTH, 3 years in Delhi and 3 years in Hyderabad and 4 years in Vellore. She has helped in setting up level 3 tertiary care neonatal units in different parts, in different places for about 25 years. Currently, she is attached to SIMS as senior consultant neonatology and pediatrics from October 2015 till date. This is a 6-bedded level 3 NICU attached to an IVF center with facilities for ventilation, HFO, NO, post-operative newborn care as well. They do follow up all newborns, NICU graduates, and have antenatal counseling. And of course, they have the rounds and they have registrars, residents, and complete 24/7 program. She's had about 8 publications in index journals, both national and international, 15 to 20 paper presentations in national forums, and awards for best paper and poster presentations. She's a certified NRP trainer and life member of NNF and IAP, has attended various national and international conferences in pediatrics and neonatology, and participated as both delegate and faculty. She's received the gold medal for best paper presentation for the first annual conference of Child Trust or the Child Trust Medical Research Society in 1995. She's a recipient of Dr. V. Gopal Raju Award for Best Paper in General Pediatrics in IAP in 1998. In 2000, she is the recipient of the first prize for the Best Paper Poster Presentation in the annual NNF Conference, Mumbai. Over to you, madam.
They operate. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Priya. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see the screen which says the only day in your life.
Yeah. Okay, I'll just.
Perfect.
Okay, fine. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, but your slides are running through.
Okay, fine. Is it okay? Yeah, right. Thank you. Thank you so much for the nice introduction, giving me this opportunity to participate in the IMA Kodambakkam. It's been my pleasure. I've been at your IMA Kodambakkam some 3 years ago in 2019 when the corona was not there. So today my topic is approach to a crying infant. And so what is cry? Cry is communication as babies cannot talk. So excessive cry or fussiness is a common reason that many parents consult the primary care physician or the pediatrician. And nearly 1 in 5 parents seek help for this problem. So we have to consider it as a clinical challenge rather than an annoyance. And the fear of missing any diagnosis may lead to a lot of unnecessary invasive tests. So why are we worried about this crying at all? Because the infant's problem of crying, feeding, and sleeping, which persists beyond the first few months of life, are usually associated with adverse behavioral outcomes in later childhood. And if these problems persist at 5 months or later, they have found out that about 5% of crying babies can have a small but a significant adverse effect on their cognitive development. So several meta-analyses have been done, and then there is an emphasis on the importance of early intervention if the crying is a problematic one. So crying too much in an infant is an important cause of maternal anxiety and stress. Obviously, it affects the breastfeeding and interpersonal relationships. The neurodevelopmental maturity varies at birth. and even in the healthy babies. And as we all know, the neonate's brain is very, very neuroplastic. So it's still in the formative years. And some infants are very temperamental. Excuse me. And they are difficult to soothe. So it has been found that cue-based care and physical contact with the caregiver right from birth is associated with settling the infant, especially in the first 12 weeks of age. And all of this are evidence-based. And as early as 2010, 2011, 10 years ago, studies have been on this field. So there is a normal crying pattern. Most babies do cry. Brazelton, who has been a pioneer about behavioral pediatrics, has said that in the initial days, first week of life or so, a child often cries for 1.5 to 2 hours. And this increases the normal crying pattern and peaks around 6 weeks of age, when it is about more than 3 to 4 hours in a day. And they've also made a curve of the infant crying based on whether they are a low, average, or high crier. So if there is any infant which cries for a length of time of about 20 to 30 minutes, then they are considered as a low crier. But if there is some baby which is crying in 5 to 6 hours in a 24-hour period, that's a high crier. And anywhere in between would be an average crier. So similarly, there are sleep needs which vary with age. So as we most of us would know, most newborns from birth till about 2 months will sleep for about 16 to 18 hours in a 24-hour period. And their night sleep will be about 8 to 9 hours, and they keep having short naps. And as the age advances, like when they are around 6 months, it reduces from about 18 to about 14 or 15 hours. And at around 1 year of age, it's about 13 hours. And as it grow older, the total hours of sleep comes down to mostly 10 hours. And the night sleep goes about, that is almost, there is the circadian rhythm which gets established. Initially, they sleep during the day and night. And as the age advances, it's more of night sleep, less of daytime sleeping. So this is the normal pattern that usually babies have to settle down to. If there is any abnormality or deviance from the abnormal cry pattern or the sleeping pattern, then obviously we are worried and we have to look into the causes. So a persistent cry, an excessive crying, or a problem crying, usually it has to follow the rule of three. It must be at least more than 3 hours in a day, more than 3 days in a week, or for persisting more than 3 weeks. I mean, it could be paroxysmal on and off, and it would be usually different in quality from the normal cry, whether it's a hunger cry or something, and can be associated with a hypertonia and inconsolability. An incidence of such a cry is usually 1.5 to 11.9% in the global population. The common causes of crying are usually non-pathological, and the commonest ones, as we all of us understand, are either due to hunger or thirst, soiled or a wet diaper in the child, or a too hot or a too cold environment. Sometimes they can be having too much of flatus, passing too much flatus and having a colicky pain, or they just want to be held. Like I told you, that is their language. And sometimes babies also feel lonely, or any sudden noise or a startling movement can make them unsettled and crying, and excessive tiredness. So we have to figure out why the baby is consolable. Otherwise, we are going to have a tough time. So coming to the systemic causes, it's obviously everything is a head-to-neck, head-to-toe approach. So in the head and neck, there might be a little repetition. I'll just go through this quickly. If you look at head and neck, eyes and ENT, there's injury to skull or the bulging fontanel. The eyes, you can have corneal abrasion, red eyes, sometimes foreign body. Otitis media and nasal condition are also common. So this is a common condition. The one on the left shows a injury, the red eye, and there is a cellulitis, the orbital cellulitis. And you can see this baby with an oral thrush with a white, sponge-like thing in the tongue. And here, this is very important. If an infant has a cloudy cornea, whether it's unilateral or bilateral, and the megalocornea, which is the size, there is a variation in the size between the two cornea, that is an indication of a congenital glaucoma. Sometimes they can have excessive watering of the eyes, and this should alert us that, you know, there's something going wrong right from birth or early childhood. And the other common conditions that we present in the office practice are the acute otitis media, These pictures show you the normal tympanic membrane and then the various degrees of bulging which happens with the severity of the otitis media that happens, that is the middle ear infection. So with a marked bulging, the child has a severe ear pain, which usually of a sudden onset and it is unbearable. Sometimes after stomatitis, like in older people, even children can have after stomatitis due to various causes. And scurvy and bleeding comes. Fortunately, nowadays we don't see much of that, which is due to vitamin C deficiency. On brushing, they can have bloodstained gums coming out, and the x-ray will show all these line of demarcation. And if you touch them, you know, they have it's very painful, the muscles or the bones, because they have what is called a pseudo paralysis. So it used to happen very much in the past when probably I was a student, but nowadays we don't see this so often. So it's more, you know, an exam question, I would say. And the systemic causes, it could be anything, gastrointestinal or genitourinary. It can start off from a just simple gastroesophageal reflux to a well-established reflex disease like a GERD. Then any causes of GI obstruction can happen. A colic is usually associated maybe with a cow's milk protein allergy, which is being seen quite often these days. And babies can also have hernia, more so in the preterm babies, because they have a lax abdominal wall and things like that. So, and then other malformations of the gut, like malrotation or volvulus, can present. A urinary tract infection or a genital tourniquet, or in the case of a testicular or ovarian testing. See, this intussusception is a very common cause of crying in an infant, especially an infant over 3 months of age. And the child keeps crying, usually draws up the legs, both the legs over the abdomen, and it is like a paroxysmal crying in between. And they can have blood in the stools like this, which was previously described like a red currant jelly. And the x-ray can show this picture of multiple fluid levels, just like a gastrointestinal obstructive pathology. Because there is a telescoping of the intestines, either the large intestine, the one into the other, or the small into the large intestine, giving you a world-like appearance on the ultrasound. The picture at the left bottom corner shows you the ultrasound image of an intussusception, and the one on the right shows you the CT scan, which again shows the world appearance because of the telescoping of the gut. And it is very gratifying, because nowadays, even without surgery, we can do what is called a pneumatic reduction or a hydrostatic reduction of this intussusception, even as an office procedure, and the child can be sent home after a few hours of observation. May not always require a surgery if it's acute and it is not associated with any other associated gut abnormalities. So coming to other metabolic causes, it could be hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, a child which is not fed for a long time. Then acidosis can happen, metabolic acidosis. And things like, the CNS, meningitis and encephalitis, where they are always associated with cerebral irritability. And an incessant cry can be also a convulsive equivalent, or it could be an early marker for a child who may develop cerebral palsy later on. A dehydrated child can lead on to a venous thrombosis, just like what Dr. Srinivas was saying, a sagittal sinus thrombosis or venous thrombosis can happen, and they can present with the excessive crying. The musculoskeletal and the skin, you can have fractures, trauma due to various causes, which could be accidental or non-accidental. Abuse must also be thought of in the present day. Dislocations and subluxations of joints can happen. Arthritis and osteomyelitis. Dactylitis is a very painful condition, especially when there is a sickle cell disease in a small infant. Myositis and cellulitis can happen. Digital tourniquet is something very strange. Sometimes a strand of hair or a strand of the small thread from the baby's dress can go around either the toes or the fingers and cause a band-like constriction and can lead on to a severe pain. Sometimes it can even lead on to an amputation. So we should be very careful that there are no loose-hanging threads in the dress, or the long strands of hair are not present in and around the child's dresses or clothing. Scalds and burns can happen accidentally by keeping any hot water or anything close to an infant, especially somebody who is crawling and trying to go and reach out for objects. Insect bites and diaperdermatitis are also common. These are some few pictures I would like to share. This is a scald, and sometimes while giving a very hot bath, some people do give a very, very hot water bath, and the child can have an absolute burn like this all over the body. This happens to be a fair child, so you can see the mosquito bite rash very well. And at the bottom is the diaper rash, because either the diapers are not changed frequently, or the quality of the diaper, or soaking too much in the urine or the feces. So as I already told you, I'll just run through this. Examination is always a head to toe. You look at the AF, anterior fontanel, then you look at nose, the mouth, eyes, ears, then look into the throat, then look at the neck for any swellings or pulsations, abnormal pulsations, will give you some cardiac cause for the disease, for the cry. Lung examination for any wheeze, any noisy breathing, stridor, which could also indicate a foreign body. And the cardiovascular examination will tell you about the perfusion or pulses and heart rate. Sometimes, you know, a supraventricular tachycardia with an abnormal rhythm and a rate can also present as just crying. And the abdominal examination, we have to look for abdominal masses. Like I told you, intussusception can also present with a mass. Any other obstruction can present with a mass. Or strangulation can also present like that. Genital examination, sometimes vulval synecdoche can be there, and the child can cry during passage of urine. And any anal fissure can also be present. The limbs and extremities, joints and skin. Very often ant bites, you know, sometimes they put oil on the baby's skin and small ants do come. So they keep biting the baby's skin, usually the scalp, and that goes sometimes unnoticed. So usually the crying due to the organic causes are usually extreme. It's prolonged and it's a high-pitched cry. And there is a lack of diurnal rhythm, because it doesn't mean that the baby cries late in the evening or in the night and it's quiet during the day. So there is no rhythm in that. And usually there are abnormal associated symptoms are there. And on physical examination, usually we do find something positive. And if the child has been crying, you know, for the past 4 months or so, you know, like I already told you, more than 3 months, 3 weeks is a prolonged cry, but it doesn't mean a continuous crying. It means in, you know, fits and starts, or the baby has episodes of crying like that. If it's a sudden onset, the usual painful thing is an otitis media. Urinary tract infection, especially in girl babies, can also present with an acute onset of crying. Raised intracranial pressure can present with crying, just like a headache. You know, if the acute crying is an counterpart of the headache in an older child or an adult. Hair tooth decay, which I already told you, of the fingers and toes can happen. Any corneal foreign body, by mistake, if something falls onto the eye of the baby, it can cause a corneal foreign body or an abrasion and lead to pain. And if it's very severe, it can go on to a subconjunctival hemorrhage or a retinal hemorrhage as well. And testicular and ovarian torsion can happen, especially in a non-descended testis and ovary in a female child. These are the common causes of an inguinal swelling with sudden onset of crying and pain. So the red flags are when we should really get alert in a child who's crying is when there is a high-grade fever, usually above 101 degrees Fahrenheit, and is associated with refusal to feed or difficulty in feeding, some amount of lethargy along with the episodes of crying, paroxysms of abnormal activity, which could be either seizures or it could be, you know, just fits of crying due to any cause, pain in some area of the body, or any unexplained bruising. Suddenly the child develops some bruises over the body. Of course, you have to think of abuse as well. And it's a sustained tachycardia, I told you, in an supraventricular tachycardia, you can start off and then present as crying. Bilious vomiting, blood in the stools, all indicating a gastrointestinal cause. And paradoxical irritability and a full fontanel point towards a CNS pathology. It could be a meningitis, encephalitis. It could be even what you call a pseudotumor cerebri because of vitamin D intoxication, vitamin A intoxication, and things like that. And sometimes a child may not move an extremity. Like if a child has a septic arthritis or an osteomyelitis of a particular bone, he may not move that extremity. Or if there's a dislocated arm or a pain, they may not move it. So movement, symmetrical movements and movement of all extremities must be looked into. The most common painful conditions are just a different way of classification. It could be medical or surgical. Again, the medical conditions are usually very painful ones are the insect bites, hair tooth decay, corneal abrasion, otitis media, and diaper dermatitis. Surgical is a strangulated hernia, torsion testis, and intussusception in that. you'll see that the otitis media keeps coming so very often. So this is just to show you some common pictures, the testicular torsion, and it's important, especially even from right from a neonate to an older child, if there is undescended testis, it's more common. Even otherwise, it can happen. It's usually a red scrotum with a lot of pain. And this picture shows, the one on the left shows an inguinal, strangulated left inguinal hernia. The one, the fingers are the digital tourniquet due to some hair cutting through the fingers or toes of the baby. And in a preterm, you can have a bilateral inguinal hernia just because of their ligaments are all lax and their abdominal musculature is lax. So investigations, usually it's only the thorough history and complete clinical examination which is most important. Investigations are of very limited value in an incessantly crying infant. First, we should learn to calm the child and only then we can kind of thoroughly examine the child. Some of the investigations which may be useful are an X-ray chest when we are thinking of a pneumonia or a bronchiolitis or a foreign body and things like that, or in the case of fractures or any gastrointestinal cause when you think of any obstruction. The ultrasound abdomen nowadays is a non-invasive test where you can find out most of the GI obstruction and an intussusception very well. And under ultrasound guidance, the intussusception can be reduced as well, like I told you. A urine analysis will give us a light about the urinary tract infection. And the rest of the investigations will depend upon the clinical findings and whether any other neuroimaging or anything else has to be done. But most often, it may not be very, very serious unless the child has a lot of other, it's an ill-looking child with a lot of other problems. So the treatment, usually common medications are prescribed and they have a very little role. If it's due to any pain, paracetamol is the drug of choice and it's quite safe even in, right from neonates to the infants. Ibuprofen is when it's a little more severe. And antipyretic also, paracetamol is the most useful one. If there is a nasal obstruction, simple saline nasal drops can be instilled into the nostrils, which will obstruct the nasal when there is a nasal obstruction, and then the child, it will be free for the child to breathe and will not have any problems. If there is any source of infection or if there is a proven infection, we have to start on antibiotics. Sometimes reflux, like I told you, the gastroesophageal reflux and colic can happen, and anti-reflux medications may help in cases where these are proven. Dicyclomine, which is a which helps to you know, it's some drops are given in some children, but it's usually contraindicated in infants less than 6 months of age because there are risk of serious adverse effects can be there. We get a lot of bloating and intestinal motility can be delayed. Cimethicone drops and colicate drops may sometimes be useful because they just help to absorb any extra gas or you know, fussiness that the baby has. Sometimes this fennel oil and dill oil, like or omum water and all that they give, but it's not proven to be of much benefit. And the certain enzymes like, you know, diastase and neopeptine drops, which contain all these concoctions, there is no scientific evidence for that. And if there is a proving of some kind of a milk protein allergy or a cow's milk protein allergy or a soy milk protein allergy, hypoallergenic formulas can be given. Or the mother, mother's diet, the mother is breastfeeding and she's on milk, she's taking cow's milk, her diet modification can be done. But all these need to be having some evidence. The soothing and pacifying techniques are usually a gentle rocking movement will help. You shouldn't do a vigorous rocking like, you know, like they do it in the traditional dhuni or, you know, because that will interfere with the semicircular canal movement. And you can cover, swaddle the baby, cover it with blankets. Soft music or a cuddly teddy bears are helpful. Obviously, holding a baby in arms will definitely soothe the baby so much. And anybody, you know, is capable, the mother sings well, then that's a good thing. So this is just to show you in pictures about the swaddling. And holding the baby like this and rubbing the back slightly will help to soothe the baby. It will help in the case of GI reflux as well and keeping him upright. And, you know, carrying the baby up. So here the father is seen doing it, which can, any member of the household can help. And how about the home remedies, which are quite often, you know, advised by parents at home or the neighbors, or we have a lot of other doctors, so-called doctors from home advising that. Gripe water, it is not recommended at all because it can have high sodium or sugar content, and sometimes even a mild light dealing with alcohol. And these things like vasambu, omam, uramarandu, and all which they do give the grant, some of the, especially in the village setup, sometimes even in the cities. And asafoetida in warm water, it's best avoided because there is a risk for aspiration infection. And especially if there is an underlying surgical conditions, it can become very dangerous. They are all acting as astringents, so they can cause harm to the gut lining as well. And we have seen babies in the past having vasambu and other things coming with a bloody diarrhea and having a lot of problems. So that is the reason that we strictly advise against the use of such home remedies. Calming procedures can be used, like putting the baby in the prone position on the tummy, warm compresses on the abdomen and massages, and a dietary modification, like I already told you. So when we think of admitting such a baby who is crying a lot, so if the child is very toxic appearing and sick, or is hemodynamically unstable with a critical illness, or it's a clinically stable baby, but it's a condition which requires IV therapy, like IV fluids or antibiotics. For instance, a child who's been vomiting a lot, or a child with infection. Or if you feel there is no access to an immediate follow-up care, the child lives in an area where they cannot immediately come and see a doctor or get any medical help. But and even if you feel there is no clear-cut etiology for that, it's better to keep them under observation at least for a 24 to 48 hours period when we know that there's nothing really ominous going on. Then social concerns, like, you know, if the mother can be just, she's a primary mother, she's very afraid, or there is poor support at home, or she feels there's unsafe environment with the infant, or any other, if we find there's a risk factor, or there is slightest chance of an abuse or a neglect, then due to social concerns, the baby can be observed in a hospital. Now, I was telling you about a colic. Infantile colic is a very common cause. About 50% of babies can present with infantile colic as a commonest reason for a crying. And the current concepts on the gut floor are high levels of inflammatory markers like fecal calprotectin and a less diverse fecal microflora and increased levels of gas-producing coliform bacteria are found in such babies who have a colic. And stress, that is, in addition to having already a colicky baby, any stress which can affect the gut motility, it changes the gut microflora and the inflammatory markers. And it increases the permeability of the gut epithelium. So they can present with loose stools and they can present with a lot of inflammatory markers which lead on to pain. And because of this, there have been several randomized controlled trials being done using the probiotic called Lactobacillus reuteri. And it has been found that this probiotic, which is present in breast milk, and it is also present available now in India in a syrup form and a tablet form, it reduces significant reduction in crying in any baby who is severely colicky, especially in an infant which is less than 3 months of age. But the treatment has to be given for 3 weeks because it's a probiotic which helps in building up a normal gut flora, helps in improving the gut motility, and in doing away with any abnormal microbiota which the baby has in the gut. Sometimes any unnecessary antibiotics are given and the gut flora is altered in the child, and this helps. So this seems to be a promising thing at present, but it's a little expensive since it's just come now and it's a 3 week therapy. So the mnemonic to remember is it cries. That is, infections, trauma can be a cause, cardiorespiratory causes have to be ruled out, then gastroesophageal reflux and reactions to other medications, and insect bites, and sometimes due to immunization. We all know that, you know, nowadays everybody is scared of immunization, but in children, there have been lots of advances in immunization with purified products. So previously, there used to be a lot of creaming episodes for children after they are taking the DPT vaccine, especially with the whole cell pertussis. But nowadays, with the coming of the acellular pertussis, these creaming episodes have come down, and many of the adverse effects, and especially even with measles vaccine and other vaccines, have come down a great deal. But still, some children who have a preponderance for that can have a little bit of crying and fever post-immunization, which settles down usually within 48 hours. And eye and ear causes have to be looked at now, and any surgical cause as well. So this is, though, a little this thing just to run over. So you look at red flags. Sometimes, you know, postnatal depression, the mother, parental postnatal depression can present as crying in an infant because the mother is upset and she's not able to settle the baby. So you go into the CSP and examination And if there's an acute onset of history of crying, then we'll have to look at raised intracranial pressure, injury, incarcerated hernia, urinary infection, corneal abrasion, and things like that. Then it has to be managed accordingly with the assessment and investigations and to diagnose or to exclude the condition. If there is no acute history of crying and it's just due to poor feeding or a frequent vomiting and diarrhea with a mucus or bloody stools with associated eczema and a poor growth, if the answer to that is yes, we should think of any cow's milk protein allergy or a soy milk protein allergy, because it's all the GI related symptoms with the rash and eczema. And that will help giving the mother a 2-week trial of rest from mother should not take any dairy or cow's milk based, cow's milk, and eliminate that from her diet. But she can take curd, because curd is already, as I told you, it has a lot of probiotics and it's good. So curd or buttermilk can be taken. And the baby can be put on an extensively hydrolyzed formula if it has been proven. It's not that you just always stop the breast milk and give something else. Not. So a pediatrician is the person who will decide on that. And if it's not due to the poor feeding or acute history of crying, and it's just a watery, explosive, frothy diarrhea with a lot of perianal excoriation with rashes, then we should think of what is called a lactose intolerance. Because the colic, the cow's milk protein allergy, and lactose intolerance are very close mimics. So we need to differentiate each of them. And the primary lactose intolerance is very, very rare. It's usually a secondary lactose intolerance due to an underlying diarrhea or any other infection. Then you can give in what is called space the feeding, block feeding, or space for every more than 3 hours. Sometimes a lactose-free formula has to be given, or lactase enzymes are now available which can be treated. If none of these are there, if medical causes are ruled out, then we should just try and see why. Is the baby tired or hungry, or is unable to self-soothe, is the cycle of sleeping and crying and feeding is not okay, and we'll have to look at how to settle down the baby and give parental support. A lot of parental counseling has to be done, and a regular follow-up also has to be done just to make sure that it's just a crying of a non-pathological case. And the probiotic, like a lactobacillus reuteri, which I told you, it's called the DSM-17938 type, which is used.
Madam, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
We have already overshot the time by a few minutes.
Okay. I'm just completing. Yeah.
Thank you.
So parental counseling is, you have to explain to them the normal pattern, the cry, sleep, and the feeding. And just like, make it conducive for sleeping, like avoid excessive stimulation, like light or noise, and darken the bedroom, and respond before the baby is too worked up. So they found that, feed management, maternal health, sleep management, and sensory motor integration is very important. Since the neonatal brain is highly plastic, and they found out that it's a bidirectional gut, enteric, and microbiota axis, which is there. So it should be an individually tailored, mother-centric and a family-centric approach, even to settle the crying infant. So I would conclude with this, Dr. Kalam, saying that the only day in your life when your mother smiles is when you cried is the day when you were born. Thank you very much for your opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for that elaborate talk on how to handle and what all to look for when there is a situation of a crying infant. Are there any questions to the speaker, please?